Thank you for the introduction. You already explained. Oh, sorry, I just see that it's not connected. Yeah, so these are the software guys which kind of work with hardware. Sorry, somehow it's not connected. Ah, that's yours. Okay, therefore. Too many hardware. So, okay, what's it all about? Yeah, it's a lot of slides, and I will talk fast, and maybe I will not cover all the slides I brought with me because I was not really sure what is the most interesting for you, because I didn't know the audience that well. So essentially what I want to talk to you, so what's my addiction as a professor? Yeah. So what I'm planning to do, to achieve until, so when I'm in debt, yeah, what should people tell about me? Yeah, what was this crazy guy doing? Yeah. And that's a little bit contrary to what other scientists do. They say, they pick different ideas over time, and then they move from field to field. Yeah, and what I'm getting is a little bit addicted to this idea that the best thing we can do as computer scientists, or as I can do, is help people in organizations working better together. Yeah, so based on my experience founding companies, seeing how they grow and how sometimes painful communication and collaboration is, I said, okay, this is really worth the effort. So therefore, first, the most important thing I want to convince you, this is really worth the effort, despite the fact that it's difficult. Yeah? And the second thing, I want to share with you some parts of my journey. And I think that, unfortunately, there's not one simple solution to it. I think it needs a lot of, because companies are socio-technical systems, and they have to do a lot with the question, let's say, what's the technology which we are all interested in? So, because we have digital media now, and that's an opportunity, but also a threat to the communication. We have economic issues. Yeah, who pays for it? How expensive is it? Where can I buy it? And you have experience issues. Yeah, do I like it? Is it fun to use? Is it cool to use? So therefore, you have these three dimensions. And it's very hard to find people which want to think in these three dimensions. So therefore, it's difficult to design and build and evolve these systems. And so therefore, the second thing is I want to share with you some of the results we achieved and how we put them all together, trying to not having simple solutions only, which work well, like Dropbox, Twitter. But if you want to collaborate, you need to bring these simple solutions somehow together. And then you get systems like SAP, which then tend to be very ugly. Yeah, and that's the challenge, let's say. How do we achieve the friendliness, the joy of use of these small vertical applications in an integrated way to tackle the problems enterprises today have to tackle? Yeah? So that's the mission statement. Yeah? And maybe you don't like to hear all the things I'm talking about, but maybe it makes you curious to visit the web pages and even collaborate with us. So therefore, it's all about working together, computer-supported collaborative work, but it's also about thinking together, because it's not enough to do things, yeah, have calendar events, send emails, but it's also about creating shared visions of the future and planning and assigning responsibilities. And so therefore, these are things which don't happen. It's just social commitments. And also, we want to help people to make these explicit in digital form with the help that together doesn't only mean we within the company, but our customers, our partners, but possibly even computers. Yeah, that computers have models which more or less understand what is happening in the organization. And it's more than data management, it's more than process management, it's more than legal obligations and implications. So therefore, together also means that we want to build semantic models, which ultimately help computers to understand and learn from our behavior and support our work. Yeah? So it's a very big ambition. Yeah? So therefore I said it has to last until I'm dead, yeah? Because I want to have to do a lot of research there. Okay, so therefore I start now with the basics. I want to show you that an organization is something like a big animal. Yeah? An organization lives in an environment. Yeah? We have employees, customers, suppliers, partners, etc. So the human part, laws and regulations, more importantly, yeah, somebody forces you to do things or disallows you to do things. You have to understand this. And it works essentially on energy, matter, information, and technology. Yeah? So the physicists and also the things what computer scientists are doing. So therefore, this is the environment which is changing. And so therefore, companies build capabilities. Yeah? They are able to sell something, to buy something, to have an inventory. And what happens is if people do this, they think about it. So therefore, they also need information management capabilities. Yeah? They build ERP systems to support this, supply chain management to do this, and do custom relationship management systems to support parts of this. What now happens is that because the environment is changing at an incredible pace, technology-wise, but also with laws and regulations in international markets, the organization has to optimize the whole behavior more or less here. And we also see disruptive changes, let's say having things like self-driving cars, which threaten an automotive manufacturer. Yeah, so therefore an automotive manufacturer also has to have a plan to coherently transform as an organization to a future state. And so if you think about this would be an animal, and it has eyes to see, and has feet to run, it needs a brain more or less to do this. And currently our brain is rather fragmented. Yeah, we don't think holistically about an organization. It's very difficult to have a view of the whole organization. It's much more difficult to say, we are doing this today, and next year we have a new strategy, or we do a merger, or we do a carve-out, like Microsoft moving from software to services, or Nokia shrinking down to a data service provider to coherently transform an organization. Yeah? And that's the big challenge I'm after. How can we use multidisciplinary results to build better information management capabilities, supporting this world where organizations build, they grow, they shrink, they combine to networks. So what's the challenge, more or less? So if I'm thinking big, then I have to cite Ray Kurzweil. Who knows Ray Kurzweil? Yeah, so his idea is essentially saying, if you look at evolution from the Big Bang, so we had information processing or information processing at different levels of abstraction. We had it in physics and chemistry, yeah, information in atomic structures. Biology then created information in DNA. Yeah, chemistry on top of physics then provided the plateau on which to do information processing in DNA. Then we generated by evolution the brain, and the brain allows to store information and manipulate information in neural patterns, more or less. Yeah? And what we have then created was the idea of having communities, that's not in the slides of Ray Kurzweil, so that people then started to build communities, enterprises, societies. Yeah? So they did social information processing, yeah, by inventing money, by having socially constructed things like universities or organizations. Yeah? So therefore, on top of the brains, we have a community of people that then invented technology. Yeah? And these this technology enables us now, like computers, to do information processing in computers. And again, what we want to do is using now, that's what I'm talking about, we want to develop social information management technology, technology which allows community of people to solve big problems and at a level and scale which is beyond human capacity. Yeah, that's the idea. So if you want to combine, if you look at this laser pointer, for example, no single person on the planet can build this because it contains lasers, it contains LCD displays, it contains plastics. So therefore, nobody can manufacture it. Only communities like of societies can do this, or companies can do this. Yeah? And so therefore, it would be nice for computers to understand how communities in organizations work. Yeah? And there's a lot of science fiction what happened after that, and I leave it up to you to read the books of Ray Kurzweil and speculate about where this would all lead to. Okay, so again, a big, bold vision, saying we want to promote this level from people working only with their brains and paper and pencil in organizations to digitally enabled collaboration within organizations and between organizations, which will transform organizations, it will transform the society. So therefore, I want to now talk a little bit, what are the issues, what kind of questions do we have, and how far did we get then in the second chapter to achieve an integration of all of these ideas, because we need to balance these three aspects, technology, economics, and also user experience. Okay, so to make it now on one slide, because I'm a scientist, you have to have a mission statement on one slide. So what is social content and model management? Yeah, it happens, I focus on organizations, and it's the whole process, not only of executing processes, but inventing new things, services or products, to build, design them, to build them, to provide them, yeah, and then to analyze how well they are being used. Yeah, that's this whole life cycle of innovations, from innovation to death. Yeah, so therefore, we want to support problem-solving processes, not only stereotypical Tayloristic processes. Somebody designs it and the machine executes it, or the workforce executes it. We want to have creative processes, problem-solving processes. The second point is what we need is social integration. It's not just enough, like we have seen with OpenStreetMaps, to put together data. We have to put together people. There are only people if they work together, and we understand how do people work together. So therefore, we have to understand we have people with different stake interests and backgrounds. It's not all computer scientists. It's not all nerds. Yeah, it's a lot of lawyers. It's a lot of salespeople. It's a lot of finance people. It's a lot of HR people. It's a lot of people like data scientists. And they also have different interests, different mental models, and we have to integrate them, yeah, or be able to bridge them to create a shared communication. Yeah, so therefore, we need this social integration. Yeah, the second level is they then work with content. Yeah, they create models, yeah, of this. They create financial simulations, how well you can sell it. They have legal implications, what happens if you point your shoot you in the eye. Yeah, there's multiple views on this device. And in order to produce this device and to propagate it and to be internationally successful, you have to have this semantic integration. Yeah, people work with tables, text, hypertext, images, drawings, videos, matrices, mathematical formula. Now, they are all valid for them. And for many of the collaborative activities, you want to integrate them somehow, that you know this points to this, this depends on this, this law applies to this part of the system. So these are the issues we have. Yeah? It's not simple. It's not that. It's very complicated nested, yeah, because there are multiple layers in the organization. And finally, what you want to do is content integration. And I think that's the easiest part. And there we made a lot of progress, really pulling in data from different sources to represent them, do analytics on them. So therefore, we have diverse content sources and channels. It's like the brain of an animal. There are a lot of sensors there, and there's a lot of subconscious things happening with information processing. But if you want to think about the future, if you want to reinvent your future, if you want to do plans, and if you want to work with other people, then you have to tie these information together in a sensible way, in a very flexible way. So therefore, it's also all about content integration. Okay, so these are the abstract, generalized concepts we need. And I want to guide you through my blueprint, more or less, how to build such systems. Yeah, that we split this big problem into sub-problems where we can make progress. And so therefore, we first ask ourselves, what kind of questions do people solve? What kind of problems do they solve when they work together? So there are these things which we know rather well to support. It's sort of talking about the presence. What is it? How many people are in the room? What is happening in the other rooms? What's the location where we are? Yeah? What's the geolocation? Then we talk about what has been in the past. Yeah, if you want to make predictions for the future, it's often good to look at the past. Yeah, how many people went to this room in the last year? How many people, what went well in the last installment of this event? And so therefore, you always, if you do planning for the future, you look at the present and what you learned in the past. So therefore, you want to have representations, temporal linked content. Yeah, so that's more or less the present, the past, and possible futures. Yeah, and there are two ways of looking at the future. There are things where people think about what can I do? And there are other questions asking what am I allowed to do or what I'm obliged to do. Yeah? So therefore, we have to model these modalities. So we need temporal modeling, historic data, but also these modalities. The second thing that happens is if you're an organization, everybody has a different picture in mind. Yeah? If I talk about something, you have associations. So therefore, and if you have a lawyer in the room and you have a computer scientist in the room, they think about different things. Yeah? So therefore, you have multiple individual and group perspectives on a certain issue. This becomes obvious if you ask people about, is this a good talk? Yeah, is this a nice room? Is this a profitable event? Yeah, so therefore, you would talk about these attributes. Yeah, you would talk about assessments. Yeah, you have a linked data model, yeah, with entities, relationships, and graphs, which are annotated and temporal, and which have different modalities. And then you would start to annotate this graph and say, I like this talk. That's a social annotation. And then people would have to agree in the next year, should we give this talk again? Should we invite Professor Mattes again? Or should we say, no, he never finished his talk, so therefore we don't invite him again. Yeah? So therefore, this would be the typical question that we then have to reconciliation, because not only one person will make this decision, it will be a collaborative decision. So therefore, we have to learn how to align goals, how to do questions, how to agree on missions, and how possibly even to develop metrics, yeah, of similarity, of appropriateness, reliability, etc. And then we have a third level of ontological reasoning or concepts which are important to represent. It's not just data and attributes, but it's also causality. Okay, why did it happen? Well, why did I arrive too late? Or why do the customers no longer buy our product? Yeah? So what happens? Yeah? And then the other question is, more importantly, yeah, nobody's interested in the past. All enterprises and animals are interested in the future. So they want to say, OK, what will happen if I do this? What will my competitors do if I do this? What will my colleagues do if I do this? Yeah, that would be reasoning, causality, intentions, uncertainty. These are the issues you have to model. Yeah, there's no, not like in OpenStreetMap, you know this tree is 5 meters high currently. But let's say, why will it maybe, why did it fall down? So it's a totally different category of knowledge. And finally, that's very important if you talk about humans. There are socially constructed realities, like money, like trust, et cetera. Yeah, so therefore, you have commitments also. Yeah, for example, if you promise somebody to give out a hit ticket, you promise him to do something in the future. And these social commitments also have to be represented. Yeah? So therefore, what you talk about, rights, obligations, commitment, and capabilities, who can do what, who has to do what, who should do what. Yeah? And these are things lawyers do, and that are regulated in contracts. Yeah, so if you write an API specification, there's somehow a contract, yeah, somebody promises you to do something, but it's not there. Yeah, it's just in the head, it's a communication act. Yeah, that somebody publishes the interface and you program against the interface. And these things are typically very implicit. Yeah, you don't talk about it. And if you want computers to help you doing this and understanding what you are doing, they have to understand this. Yeah, and so that's the challenge. Yeah, it's not enough to have we have to cover all these different layers, in particular with the fact that multiple people do concurrently contradictory things. Yeah, there's no shared reality, it's all socially negotiated reality. And if you look now at the tools that are being developed, there are a lot of cool tools being developed. Yeah, you have, here's something like BI tools for data integration, causal loop diagrams for talking about causal relationships with delays and feedback loops, etc. You have business rules, content management systems, data warehouses, log analysis, time series, stock and flow diagrams, all kinds of models and tools which help you to do parts of the work. Yeah? And what we are interested in, okay, is it necessary or is there a common semantic foundation for these multiple tools? Now that's the question more or less. So therefore what we see as what needs to be improved is you have, it's difficult to integrate content from these different tools, yeah? Yeah, from a design with a creativity technique to some brainstorming session, to a wiki, to a process definition, to some KPI definition, to some contract. Yeah, there are some links, but we want to integrate and model these links, and therefore it's necessary for us to have adequate representations of these things. We need content integration. Then we need the social integration. Yeah, when we talked about OpenStreetMaps, there is no notion of ownership, of protection, rights, obligations associated with the data. So therefore, it's not really for an enterprise which wants to survive by having private data or shared data, that visibility of data, access rights, and obligations. At least you want to have RACI models, access control lists, you want to have stakeholder-specific information and presentation. You don't want to look at the raw data, but you want to have views that depend on the rights and the social position of the person looking at the data. And what's also very bad is that if you build systems which you connect them, like in a large organization, these are SAP systems and CRM systems of an automotive provider, it starts to get very entangled. Yeah? So they optimize the existing processes, but as soon as you want to change something or you want to radically change the organization, this is no longer possible. So therefore, currently, the effect of using computer-based tools is to limit your creativity, to limit your ability to change. Yeah, you know all about agility. So nowadays, companies want to be agile, and if you build systems like this, you connect all these systems with at a very low level of data, then you don't get this. Yeah, so therefore, my vision is we should find a better way, a more abstract way, and or a more agile also way of doing this. Okay, so that's more or less the vision. And I think if I convince you that this is a valuable vision, maybe also the most important part of the talk is achieved. So the next 15 minutes I will use somehow to squeeze into screen dumps, shall we just say, how does the system look like? What do you do with the system? I don't talk so much, like in a scientific talk, about how do we do it internally, and there's a lot of information about this on our website, but how does it feel to the user? And I have to admit, this is the weakest part of our system, yeah? But because we didn't involve in the past enough web designers, user experience specialists, etc. Yeah, we really talked about how to do this technical integration, how to have the semantic integration, but what we learned is we then need for the future a lot of different user frontends. Yeah? For your iPad watch, you want to have a different user interface than if you talk here on the Beamer. So therefore, the way in which you consume the information, in which you enter information, like we saw it with OpenStreetMap in the morning, if this is a bottleneck, that it's hard for people to capture information, to provide feedback, to annotate things, then the data gets stale. Yeah? There is a disparity between the data and the processes in your IT and the reality. And to make sure that this is totally aligned, you need to tightly follow the people what they are doing. Yeah? And this, the nice part now is, with all these handies or mobile phones you have, we can collect enormous amount of voice data, video data, what I'm doing. But this is not accessible to the computer. Yeah? So if somebody would follow me, my wife, she would know what's happening with me. But if a computer would follow what I'm doing, it's hard for the computer to make sense of what I'm doing. Yeah? So therefore, we need to be more explicit. What are my intentions? What are my goals? What's the social context in which I am? And therefore, the user interface, which has to decide which information to present to me, and which information I want to enter at that position, should know much about the user interface. So if I'm talking about user interfaces, they look crappy, and you're cordially invited to help us to build better user interfaces, and we change the architecture of the system to make this possible. That was the biggest change in the last year, that we said, okay, up to now that was all very fine, but it was too much brain-centric, what's happening in your head. We should focus more on the voice and on the eyes and on the interaction. Yeah. And that's, I think, also where the current research of my group goes to. So, okay, what's the big picture? So the idea is you want to build the sociocortex server. And sociocortex essentially says it's something like a brain, but it's not just a BI repository or the Hadoop server, which simply stores data, but it should be a brain-like structure. So it should first contain the content graph, yeah, the relationships, the necessary and relevant relationships between the content, which comes from multiple data sources. Yeah? So there are a lot of operational systems. Not all the data has to be created here. Some other data can come from backend systems, from Twitter, from the other feed sources. Or importantly, you import the identities from different sources, the intranet, the LDAP server, Facebook, whatever. So you want to have the notion, who are the people? So you want to model the social graph. And then you want to perform operations on that. And you want to create this activity graph. Who did what, when, with somebody, why, with which quality, with which readability, et cetera. Yeah? That's more or less this information that's created also in your brain, yeah? Your memory, more or less, what you did, and a semantic representation why you did it, which enables you to plan, to communicate, and also to invent new things. Yeah? And so therefore, if we are making progress towards this goal, making sense of these multiple users here and user groups which consume and produce information interactively here and other content sources we have more with digital representations, then we make maybe progress towards this goal of better collaboration, but better service management, better enterprises using these systems. As I told you, the system now then performs the social integration, the semantic integration, content integration, and should support yeah, and with improving degree, these collaborative activities like modeling the world, assessing the quality of this modeled, shared, conceptually modeled world, to reason about it, to do negotiations, who should do what, to make plans, to execute plans, and to coordinate action. And these, I think, belong intrinsically together. If I look at cybernetic systems, they all have this structure. Yeah, if you know the viable system theory, they think in this that you need such a reflective core on which people work. What we learned is that we had this system with a predefined user front end. And we learned two things. There are people which work and which have a low level of abstraction in their work. Yeah? They want to work with the data you have. Yeah? They want to use Google Maps. They want to use Twitter. And then there are people which build new things, yeah? And they work at the level of models. Yeah? They say, well, how should this look like? They generalize from the individual problem. So therefore, we now provide two front ends. One is a web client for working with the data, like a customer database, Dropbox, whatever, and others where you can design and connect and integrate these services and these capabilities. That's the web integrated modeling environment. And that's what we learned is these are different people. They need a totally different user front end, which is tightly linked with the semantics of the other front end. So these are the two generic front ends you get if you model information in social cortex. What we also learned is that people want to have very tailored views. Yeah? If you have an integrated, let's say, SharePoint, people, these big systems tend to have a lot of functionality, but then people are confused. Yeah? They, they can do a lot of things in SharePoint, but only the SharePoint administrator knows what to do. Yeah? So one anti-pattern of these integrated solutions is that they get a very big, hard to understand user interface. Yeah? Look at SAP, look at Sugar CRM. After time, they have more and more features because you need these features, but not everybody needs these features. So therefore, our belief now is we have to separate this strictly here. There's a lot of dynamic development here with the different web developers or UI designers, which work with a unified API versus the server to do these different things, so which then in the end look like a tailored vertical social application. Yeah? That's also a research project we have with Siemens. What are these search vertical social applications? Somebody working with Solid Edge or working with a Eclipse as a programmer, what's the social context in which a programmer wants to have social interaction and wants to use these services? So that's the big picture. And now we look at this web client, and I show you how do you interact with the system and how you consume or generate or benefit from these capabilities of the social cortex server. And in order to explain these, I also can give you some, I think, feedback how to build these systems in general. Essentially, you need a layered architecture where the lower layers are expanded with capabilities of the higher layers. So the basic idea is if you consume it, that we have now a very nice API, REST API, which more or less is very lean, but very expressive, which allows you first to work on this temporal data for semi-structured link content. Then you have, on top of this, dynamic content models, yeah, type systems, yeah, where you talk about conceptualization. You define entities, relationships, cardinalities, constraints, subclasses, aspects, etc. This happens on top of the data. Yeah. We already do since 10 years that what people now call data lake. Yeah, you first collect data, and then incrementally you provide multiple typed views on the data, which are useful for cognitive capabilities. Yeah, so therefore, I'm a strong believer in type systems, but type systems, it should not be schema first and then data, filling data into the schema, but you first have the data and then people recognize the patterns in the schema and then they can develop the schema. So therefore, we always start with data first or links first or attributes first, and then we try to make sense with it and enforce structure by having dynamic content models. On top of this, you want to have this notion of that you have secrets, yeah, or that you have rights and obligations at data. Yeah? So who owns the data, who has access to the data, who can contribute data, who can delete data. You want to have discretionary and role-based access control models on top of these data and the models. You want to have, for individual items, say, about this pointer, who is allowed to see this and talk about this, modify its design. That's one part for one instance, but you could also say, okay, for all our entities in a certain type, we want to define access control models. So once you have done this, you then already you have data. Now you want to talk about calculations, computations, reasoning. So therefore you need, and we say, okay, we don't want to have rule engines. We don't want to have, we really want to have functional languages. Yeah, to talk declaratively about reasoning that you have the data, you don't change the data, or you have the whole history of the data, and based on this history, you then do new computations, and this is already input, which can be used for further computations. Yeah, we do the same thing like GitHub and all the nice repositories do. Don't throw the old data away, because it's very valuable in the future, for example, in OpenStreetMaps, to know which streets have been built, which border lines have been changed, etc. Yeah, so therefore, I think it's very important that these queries work on the whole functional history. Yeah, you don't work on the current state, but you can also connect past states, the current state, and future states through these computations. And finally, you want to have on top of this, yeah, as you know it in programming language, you have data, functions, and processes, or threads. you want to talk about long-term collaborative, in this case, activities. So therefore, we talk about dynamic process models. Now, you know this if you do, for example, a design for this event. You design a plan, who has to do what when. Yeah, and that's, this plan is that the important thing to coordinate the activities of all the participants and all the organizers, and then you want to execute this plan. And while you're executing the plan, you're learning that you make exceptions and you want to enrich the plan. And then the revised plan, what you have learned, is again a combination of a process model, of a functional knowledge about the dependencies, yeah, how much food do people consume, and the data, yeah, what data do we have to collect, which attributes do we need. Yeah, so therefore, this emergent structuring is the important point, that you do instances, you work, and if you observe your work and you are able to look at the data, what you did, how good you did it, what were the functional connections and the reasoning part, the logic more or less, and who did what when. This is a useful input for then generalizing, to come up with data models, with access control models, with computational models, and with process models. Yeah? And it's first the data, and then the models, and then you later on question the models, because you can always improve a model. Yeah, so therefore, we have this continuous process. So now, and we'll now go through this, because if we do education training with the people, let's say, that use the system in our intranet, I don't tell this story. I simply tell them, this is the user interface, you do this, but behind the scenes, I want to make the connection because you are not so much interested in the user interface. We first tell them how to create data, then how possibly, if they are advanced users, to structure the data and enforce constraints on the data, tables, trees, and visualizations, like in Excel. Then how to protect the information, that's easy, that they do from start day one, yeah, to make access rights, my private wiki, our shared team wiki, the customer-facing collaboration platform. Yeah, that's what you think about. Whenever you create data, who owns it, for who has access, who should have access, that's very important. Therefore, this happens even more frequently down here. And then you talk about, they collaborate, they talk to each other with Twitter feeds, and then you generate these models. Okay, I see it will be hard for me to stick in time. So this is the perspective. You have multiple workspaces, look at a wiki. Yeah, you have multiple wikis for different user groups with their different access rights. Within the wikis, you can generate wiki pages which are linked arbitrarily. The blue things would be something like pages. These pages can be linked arbitrarily. We think it's very important to have the value concept, so therefore we have also aggregation. So hierarchies, like a folder, if you delete a folder, all subfolders are deleted. If you delete a comment, post, you want to delete all comments. Yeah. So therefore, intrinsically, we have not only associations, bidirectional links, but also aggregation hierarchies. What you also do is you think in terms of tables or collections. Yeah, for example, the list of all meetings, or the collection of all meetings, all context information in a project. You have a project blog, or you have a time series, which have a temporal order of the events. So these are the three basic structuring mechanisms on one slide. And what people do is, more or less, they have this user front end, and it looks like a little bit like a file system with a wiki to the right. Yeah, you have, for example, here a workspace project management with my first project, which has a project wiki and file sharing, and there might be multiple other projects. So you get a hierarchical navigation structure, which is very useful for represent things like documentation, laws, contracts, requirements. Text is mostly organized in a hierarchical fashion, more or less, or content. What you also have, you have a navigation based on the types of objects you're working on. Yeah? You have tables, things, yeah? Table-like things, like or entities, Arbeitspakete, working packages, files, contacts, meetings, projects, text pages, enterprises. And you can incrementally enrich this model. And you can also move to other workspaces. Yeah? So therefore, if you have a large organization, it's not one shared wiki, but it's 50 wikis. Yeah? If you look at the intranet or our faculty, there's something like 30 wikis. And some of them export information to other wikis, or data structures, or processes to other wikis. So therefore, you can have independent teams working decentralized. Or if they want to share information, they can federate information to a centralized place. So therefore, this notion of workspace is also important, that which allows you to have this balance between individual perspectives and shared perspectives. Yeah? So that this process of forking and joining and merging is intrinsic part of the platform. It's not done outside of the platform. Yeah? So it's not one data model, one wiki base, DB wiki, But there are multiple DB wikis because there's multiple, even within one organization, different ways to look at a promotion, at a PhD thesis, for example. So what's now the basic idea? The initial project was called Hybrid Wiki. So the idea is like a wiki page. It's a title, it has a version history, author information, tags for searching, but it has also attributes like in semantic wikis where you can define define attributes, for example, start date, end date, and the values. And you have so-called free values, which are not defined at the schema level, but individually for some projects. So you can dynamically add new links or attributes to a page. You also get this information that all links you are creating can be navigated in both directions. You can also see who links to this project. And then you see there are some meetings which link to this project, and there are some work packages which link to this project. So therefore, over time, you get this big temporal graph over time. So that's the basic idea. Unstructured data, pictures, videos, you can embed a lot of stuff here, and structured things. You have a version history. I don't go into this. And then people, if you give it to people, people then build very different pictures of the world for museums, for enterprise architects, for medical people. So we have given this to different people, and they create their more or less UML models of their world by incrementally creating the data types, and creating these data structures with access controls. What is then interesting is that they not only can embed content, passive data, but also active content into their pages. They can, for example, embed an expression, like in JavaScript, some some function, which is evaluated whenever you visualize the page. Well, basically, that's the idea. It could also be visualized or generated or cached the result. So therefore, you can embed embed functions, and you can also embed data widgets. Like in Excel, you can have a visualization of your data. So therefore, you incrementally create more or less these pages with data and functions, functional dependencies. What is important, if you have embedded references, for example, you want to display, you have a project, you want to calculate the sum of all employees, you would write something like this in the page as an attribute definition, this team dot sum costs, that's more or less something like language integrated query, where you have a strongly typed programming language, where you can more or less define your derived attributes. So for example, if your project, it has employees, then the employees have a cost, then the project cost is calculated by these employee costs. And then you have a type checker which knows the dependencies, and then you can do refactoring. If somebody changes the schema and says, no, it shouldn't be called costs, then you do recalculation, refactoring, so that the function definition no longer refers to costs, but let's say to total cost or estimated cost. So therefore you have an integrated programming language with the database schema, and you can do both things. You can change both of them, and the consistency is checked. This also allows us to do dependency checking. So if you have very large complicated calculations, like the Bilanz, what's it in English? The Gewinn- und Verlustrechnung, so the total budget of a year, then the total budget would change if you buy something. So you have a calculation which calculates the total budget. And whenever you change something, you have to recalculate all these derived values. And very large, potentially millions of nodes. So therefore, we need caching strategies and dependency analysis to do efficient calculation for that. So that's more or less the idea for link management. So because links are not only introduced by associations, but they're also introduced by calculations. If you calculate something with recursion, you create a very powerful virtual dependencies, which then also talk about these dependencies. Okay, so therefore, this then allows us to auto-completion. If you type in your expressions, you don't do like in JavaScript something, you hope that these variables exist, but the system guarantees you if you use attributes, if you use function names, if you send parameters, there is a type checker which is polymorphic, which checks that this works. So therefore, you need this power in such a platform. This then leads to the idea of having spreadsheets. So the idea is you have the base data from all your sources, and also created through the interaction with the system. Yeah, these would be the activity feeds or the X writes and applications. Now that's the data. You have then calculations on them. You embed them into pages. You create this huge like spreadsheets in a large organization. Yeah, somebody looks at this data, produces this spreadsheet. Somebody uses the data from this spreadsheet or from this database or from this app. So therefore, this is more the big picture, the functional picture, because it's a purely functional language that you create your visualizations based on the data, and you have the full traceability, let's say, about accountability, who entered data relevant for this, who should be notified, because the graph is not only the data, but it's also the social relations, who defined the function, who defined the argument, who changed the argument. So therefore, you get something which is very similar to Excel spreadsheets with embedded graphics, which are consumed by different users based on their access rights, but it's collaborative, it has access right control, it's talking about linked data, not only about flat data. So therefore, this is then these hybrid wikis and their features. You can then can create visualizations like this to consume the information, and as I told you, they look right now crappy, because it was done by student arbeiten. You can get much nicer visualizations nowadays with AngularJS, and there's essentially the idea to have an open interface so that different people can generate these visualizations on this API. And I'm currently in the process for enterprise architecture management tools to push towards the standardization of this API so that based on this integrated data model, meta model, people can create such visualizations. And there's a wizard, to, like in Excel, that you point to the data and you create your visualization based on your data, and then you can provide visual views on this very linked data space. And then we are currently doing a spreadsheet 2.0, so that you can do this also incrementally, because people also want to dynamically create their own spreadsheets, more or less, in this. Yeah, because that's the best way for users to express their information demands and to create dashboards that they pull in information from different sources and show it on one dashboard. And here we simply have one table view with embedded links, but this also scales to much more complicated Excel spreadsheets. The final thing I want to show is the process support. I simply show you one example, which has been used in by partners in the US. They talk about open data projects, or the open, what's the name of the project? Open scientific projects. Their tagline is more saying, okay, in the old days, you have a scientist who creates one thing. Then you had Crick and Watson in small groups creating more or less shared results, because it was interdisciplinary. And now if you look in the science, the same thing that happens like in Daimler or BMW, you have a lot of people producing a car. Yeah, so therefore you need collaborative research. And if you look at the Large Hadron Collider, there are even networks of people collaborating to find the Higgs boson. Yeah? So therefore the collaboration, the complexity of your product or your problem means a larger part of people. And then the important question arises, how do people of this size coordinate their work? Yeah, so therefore they used our system in this organic data science, the project has been called in the US. They used our system to show the progress of such work. Yeah? So the basic idea is if you do research, you have research plans. Yeah? You want to do something, you delegate tasks to other people, and then these other people more or less work on these tasks, and you get some feedback how much progress they made, and then maybe they find out this doesn't work, so you have to revise the plans. So therefore, the idea was very simple, that this notion, hierarchical notion of wiki pages with data, you can now create so-called artifact-driven workflows. Yeah, so that you say for each of the objects, for example, if you create a description of this workspace at this workshop we have currently, there would be the overall goal: run the TNG big day, big data day. Yeah, and then somebody would assign responsibilities for some things, catering, marketing, etc., and they would start working on it. And the idea is, if the people don't simply work on it and getting emails, but they really say, "I'm working on this work item," they can show you now that we see now the wiki page, as we have seen it, you have your attributes, and you know what you're working, and now you simply have to make the connection. Who, if I want to do this, if I want to do catering, I need some price for the catering in the end. Yeah, that's the ultimate thing you want to know, how much does it cost, and then a plan to drill down. So therefore, you would assign a task to somebody, say, provide me, do this catering, and provide me the information here, or what I need. Yeah, so therefore, you pull this data to the tasks, And then you create now this linking between tasks, activities, and the work plan. And this work plan more or less then emerges during working. And then after a while, you can see, OK, how did we do the last time this conference? You see all these subtasks. And then you can create a better plan for the next year. Yeah? And that's basically the idea that this level of coordination, yeah, of speech acts, of commitments, of obligations is then captured in a very natural and easy understandable way. Yeah? And I think that's important. Yeah, I don't want to talk about speech act theory to my developers or my programmers or my users. They should think in terms of Gantt charts and work plans and activity models there. Okay, so a little bit, I stop here. Yeah, I think this was the main message I want to show you. To summarize, so there's a lot of information more. So essentially, what we achieved, technical understanding how this can be built, yeah, how this scales, well, with Elasticsearch in the cloud with multiple servers. We have an implementation of this in the Deutsche Telekom business marketplace. Nobody knows what's behind it. But we also now decided to make it open source, so therefore this will be an open source system at the end of the year. And we then invite multiple people to develop new front ends and to integrate new content types. Yeah? Because now currently we are talking about the classical data types, but also then Excel spreadsheets and text. Yeah, text analytics, and we see there's a need also integrating models like CAD models, 3D models, geographic models as basic element types to do reasoning on them. Yeah, because geographical, geospatial reasoning has different properties than the reasoning process we currently can support on linked data and on textual data. Yeah? And so that's more or less the research agenda until I'm dead. Okay, thank you for your patience and attention, and now I take your questions.
How long will it take until your vision is complete?
Yeah, so there are two. So the question is, what is complete? Yeah, so the vision, I think, is never complete. And it's also unrealistic what I learned to expect that this becomes reality through us. Yeah, so it's the same thing like if you look at what we did in the past when we founded Cormedia, that we more or less really understood. Had an impact on industry later on, how this happens. Yeah, or like if you look at Smalltalk, yeah, the Smalltalk people, you don't build systems with Smalltalk, but based on the ideas of Smalltalk. So that's the idea. So I want to demonstrate that it's not just an idea, but it's a running system where we can observe the behavior of the people using the system. And so therefore, what I'm doing, I create spin-off companies. They are marginally successful, and typically, what happens, they take this. And they build one vertical solution on top of it, and they ditch the generic part of it. Yeah, and that's clear in the current economy because we cannot compete against SharePoint or whatever. Yeah? So therefore, that's the economic answer. Will it become reality in this form as this system? But I think what I would be very happy, what I have seen in the past with our other research, that people pick up the ideas. Yeah? They are inspired by the ideas, and they build according to these ideas. Yeah? And that, I think, is... And I do hope that I infected you thinking in terms of what should be the layering and then talking to us, how do you do this extension, this dynamic extension, yeah? Because it should not be a monolithic system. Yeah? So it's important to have these layers because these are very complicated algorithms and if you do this at scale, it's difficult to engineer it. And that's interesting research, but I want to have a framework for our research that I don't have to start again, yeah? Because I don't get this currently from somebody else, so therefore we have to build it ourselves to do the research. All relevant. So the idea is to have people allow people in one common language or common meta model to represent their data, and if they want to collaborate, to link their data.
Right. But yeah. How difficult is it for people to make these connections and do the linking?
It's not that difficult because people have very difficult problems, and they want to do this. Yeah. So we have should have shown you the long list of the companies that use it. They use it for a very different purpose. Museums, as I said, universities, healthcare providers, enterprise architects, data modeling experts, we want to trace dependencies. We are using it in legal research. Because all people which are not satisfied with the current way of storing information, they want to use it for their very specific use cases. So therefore, the usage more or less determines also the kind of data structures or the meta model, the models you're creating.
So maybe I should go deeper into the problem I have. So in an open source context,
yeah,
when someone changes something,
yeah,
usually the documentation goes out of date.
Yeah.
Because most people, the person who changes something doesn't choose to update the documentation, but
yeah,
they simply don't know that the documentation is
somewhere
else. So would this be used to address that problem?
And definitely, yeah, because that's what people do. You have a button, like on Wiki, you say follow. And you kind of follow a page, and if the page contains derived data, whenever the something, and you have a, let's say, a calculation which identifies all things which are dependent, it doesn't have to be directly linked, then you get a notification as soon as somebody changes the code, that you say, this documentation documents that code, and then you can say, notify me if anything what I told you changes, then you get notified, and people can subscribe to this feed. Yeah, so you have an activity feed, and then you see all the changes of people, and you have a personalized notification list. And therefore you have what happens is the social graph gets typically as big as the data graph. Yeah? If you look at OpenStreetMaps, I wonder they only show the data, the people, yeah, they should say who tagged what, who is doing what, I want to follow other people, I want to have a gamification. Yeah? So if you do this in enterprise, you want to show people okay, what did this guy do? Yeah, which projects did he do with these tags? Yeah, so you want to have this activity feed where you see who did what, who commented what, who talked to whom, who tagged what, who linked what, who completed which task. And if you have tasks tagged with some capabilities, like this is a CSS task, this is a testing task, this is a financial calculation task, over time you create a profile with skills, yeah, that you know what capabilities do these people have. So therefore, you know much more about your people. Yeah? Because in the end, you don't not only want to have data about the reality, but you want to know who knows to engineer this, who to talk to, who did the last time the calculation. Did he did the calculation well? Did he get positive feedback? This is the kind of data we are looking at. So maybe that was wrong. So this, on the left-hand side, this is not only data, but it's the activity, it's the data graph, the activity graph, and the social graph. So therefore, you not only do calculations about the data, but you do calculations about the user behavior. And that would be the part where machine learning things would work nicely, that you do data process mining, you do skill detection, because you make this information during humans work visible, and therefore you can use algorithms, yeah, machine learning algorithms, deep learning algorithms, hopefully in the future, to do this pattern detection automatically. Right now you need a modeling expert who looks at this data model and says, okay, it would make sense to have an attribute, or this attribute doesn't make sense, this should be merged, this has to be done by humans currently, that you change the schema based on the data in the system, but in the future we want to have suggestions from a machine saying this data in OpenStreetMap, nobody does it, so the system automatically recommends you to not do it. And we don't want to do an OpenStreetMap thing, but we want to do this in a very general way, because I strongly believe, as our brain is capable of handling all this data in a very uniform way, it makes sense to try to really integrate all this information into one system. Yeah, because that's what other people say, you need a DO database for this, and you need a big data store for that, and you need an Excel for that, can I say? Yeah, but in our brain, it all comes together because only then we can reason about it. And so therefore, I want to bring it together. And it's a very ambitious goal that typically people don't want to do, because as a small company or as a commercial entity, it's hard to think now away from these vertical applications. Yeah? Because only SAP thinks like this, or Google thinks like this. Yeah? And no German company or whatever would dare to build something like this, because they say we never will earn money with it. So therefore, it's important that researchers try to do it and infect other people and show that it's feasible. Yeah? So therefore, that's my ambition. Okay.
Consolidated, yeah, to a clever system, mm-hmm, to use it, but how does the way back work? Because
yeah,
Otherwise, you create the same thing you try to solve yeah. by saving the data in only your system.
Yeah, therefore, I think while I'm presenting it, I saw it. Yeah, it looks we integrate the data and we do a little bit of data transformation cleaning and then we show it. Yeah, this looks ethical. Yeah, but therefore, it's important to say, no, so these data also contains the functions are represented as data. Or the change of a function, the call of a function, these are all data. Yeah, they are data streams. Yeah, so or if these people do a Twitter, this Twitter action is here. So therefore, this is reflective of the system. Yeah, the data models is data. So therefore, it's not social content management, but the social content and model management. Yeah, so these are the models. These are the data models, the access control models, the calculation models, the process models. So they are here, and you do calculations, reasoning, because you do multi-level reasoning. Yeah, you look at the modeling activity to build a higher-level model how to do project management. Yeah, and so these higher-level processes can only be done if the calculations here and the output and in the interactions and the interactions are also made visible as data. And that's essentially what Google is doing. Yeah, they look at your use of the cartographic data to learn what is useful cartographic data. For example, if you enter a link in our system, the system looks at what are the most popular items in the last weeks, and you get suggestions based on popularity. So these are things all under the hood. Nobody sees it. It behaves like a normal database, but it's a clever database. So our users say, is this der Fuchs? Yeah, in Germany, you know it. Der Fuchs hat schon wieder rausbekommen, was ich meine. Yeah, because we have all our slides and all slides of the faculty in one repository. And if you look for Florian Mattes, there would be millions of objects which contain my name in the slides, yeah, because they're full text indexed. But the system knows that people always go to my homepage. Yeah, so therefore, if I ask for Florian Mattes, Elasticsearch tells me, yeah, look for the homepage. And then people say, oh, I want to go to the homepage. Or they say, no, I want to get the latest PowerPoint uploaded yesterday to the Big Tech Day. Yeah, so therefore, if the system knows about behavior of the people, this becomes reflective. It can think about its own use of the models, and it can do meta-model-like things at a very naive, easy-to-understand way. Yeah, we don't use old semantic, very complicated buzzwords. For the users, it's just wiki pages with attributes and Twitter feed, more or less. Yeah. Okay, so but everybody who wants to talk to me later on can do this, and I now wish you a happy break, and thank you for your attention.